Hi! In this video, we are going to interface a PS2 keyboard with a microcontroller in our nerdkit, and along the way, we're going to learn about interrupts. In microcontroller programming, as in normal programming for PCs, there is an inherent disconnect between the way we write code and the way things actually happen in real life. When you sit down to write a function or a method, you write a sequence of statements that all happen one after each other. Even with the use of control structures and calls to other functions, you can still follow a single path through the code, starting with the main function. While this paradigm might be fine for thinking about simple programs and algorithms, it doesn't really work when thinking about larger systems. Sometimes systems need to interact with each other, and your code needs to react to outside events in an asynchronous way. To accomplish this in microcontrollers, we have something called an interrupt. Like you would expect, an interrupt looks much like a function, except it only executes when outside events happen, so you don't have to call it directly from your main function. Think of it this way. Say I'm trying to add up all these numbers. That's my main loop. 2 is 6.
Interrupt!
I handle the interrupt, and then go right back to my main loop. There are many different types of interrupts available to you on the ATmega 168 chip, but for the most part, you're going to find yourself using one of two main types of interrupts, timer interrupts and pin change interrupts. Timer interrupts are best used when you want to fire off a quick task at a regular time interval. You can choose to fire a timer interrupt when a timer overflows, or when the timer reaches a particular value. The best example of timer interrupts can be found in the Crystal real-time clock code. In that example, we wanted to have a way of telling real-time using a microcontroller. Since our Crystal runs at a very steady 14.7 MHz, we use a timer interrupt to fire every 1/100th of a second. The interrupt handler simply increments a variable every time it is fired. Here, the timer and incrementing of the variable is handled completely outside of the main code. Once the interrupt is set up, it will fire and increment the variable by itself without your code having to worry about it. This allows you to run other tasks like updating the LCD or doing whatever else your project requires, but now with a real-time variable at your disposal. Check out our real-time clock video for more details on this project. The other often used type of interrupt is a pin change interrupt. These types of interrupts are very useful when communicating with outside devices. To demonstrate that, we put together a quick little project that interfaces a PS2 keyboard with our nerdkit. The PS2 protocol is very simple and very easy to interface with a nerdkit. Here, we just chopped off the connector end of the keyboard cable, and you can see there are four wires corresponding to ground, power, a clock line, and a data wire. The clock and data line are normally not moving until the keyboard wants to send a character. Each key press is sent as 11 bits read on the falling edge of a clock line. First a start bit with the data line low, then 8 bits of the character, least significant bit first, then a parity bit, and finally a stop bit. Most keys on the keyboard are represented using an 8-bit scan code. Some of the keys are extended keys that require more than one byte, but for now, we are just going to ignore those. We hooked up the keyboard to our oscilloscope so you can see the protocol working. When I press the F key, we can see the clock and data line start moving. On each falling edge of the clock, the data line represents the current bit. Here we can see a 0 for the start bit, then a 1 for the first bit of the data. Then there are 8 data bits, followed by 1 parity bit, and finally the stop bit. So now it becomes a question of reading the clock and data signal directly on our pins of the microcontroller with the use of pin change interrupts. The clock line is hooked up to PC4, which if we check on our data sheet, is also PCN12. The first step is to write our initialization function to turn on the interrupt on that pin. Pin change interrupts are explained on the data sheet starting on page 70. The main registers you have to worry about are the pin change interrupt control register and then the corresponding pin change mask register. There are only 3 pin change interrupts controlled by the pin change interrupt control register. The data sheet states that the pin change interrupt 1 fires on a pin change of PCIND 14 through 8. So we turn that bit high since we want to enable PCIND 12. So now the pin change interrupt is enabled for pin changes on PCIND 14 through 8, but we have to set the PC mask register to enable the individual pins to trigger the interrupt. Since we are setting pin change interrupt 1, we set PC mask 1 and turn on the corresponding bit for PC IND 12. Now that our interrupt is set to fire every time PC IND 12 changes, we need to write the interrupt handler that will actually run. For that, we use the ISR notation, which takes a vector as its argument. The vectors available can be found in the AVR libc documentation. In this case, we want PC int 1 vect. Now this interrupt handler will run when there is a change on PC int 12. Inside the handler, we have a little logic to actually read the pin and verify that the clock line is currently low. Then we simply read the current value of the data line and read that into our variable. After 11 bits, our kbddata variable will hold the scan code. Notice we also have a variable called carWaiting. This is used by the interrupt handler to let the main loop know when a character is ready to be read. When a character is ready, the interrupt handler flips this bit to high. When the main program reads the character, it flips it back. This is a common technique to communicate between interrupt handlers and the main program. There is some other logic in the interrupt handler to handle keyups, which the keyboard also reports, and special keys like Shift, Enter, and Backspace. Not all the keys are actually supported in our simple demo program, but implementing more functionality would be a great exercise. In this program, there is a little bit of more code that turns the scan code into a character that was pressed. The main program only prints the characters to the LCD, but you could easily imagine doing more complicated things with the keyboard input. See our printf and scanf tutorial for more ideas about how to do input and output. Now that you see how useful interrupts can be, you need to be aware of some of the problems they can cause. The biggest thing to be aware of is that you are interrupting the main code. It is way too easy to think of them as merely running in the background. That is simply not true. Your main loop is pausing for the interrupt handler to run. The other thing you need to be aware of is how long your interrupt handlers take to run. If you take too long, you're actually going to start blocking other interrupts from firing that might have fired. You might even get stuck in a situation where interrupts are firing one after each other, and your main loop never gets a chance to run. I hope you have learned a little bit more about interrupts and how they can be used in different situations. Our website has more information about potential pitfalls that you will come across when dealing with interrupts. For more information about this project or more videos like this one, visit us at www.nerdkits.com.